Good morning to all. Myself Suganya, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering. Today we are going to see about surveying. What is meant by surveying? Surveying is the art of determining the relative position of an object on or below the earth's surface. In that, the word relative position, which means position stands for with respect to something. In order to specify our college, what we can tell, from Karur it is 20 km away, from Namakkal it is 30 km away. Like that, here Karur and Namakkal are the reference point, our college is the object to specify. This is said to be surveying. The main objective of surveying is to prepare plan or map. What does mean by plan? Plan is a small scale object. For example, if you want to specify the boundary of a any building, it is said to be a plan. What does mean by map? If you are specifying a boundaries of any countries, for a large scale of surveying, it is coming under map. What are things to be taken from plan? The horizontal distance and directions. For example, in plan, we can measure the horizontal distance and directions. In map, we can also measure the horizontal distance and also the vertical distance. Vertical and horizontal distance. This vertical distance are taken from the map called contour mapping. Next, we are going to see about the classification of surveying. Surveying is primarily classified into two types. First one, geodetic surveying, then plane surveying. Suppose we are surveying an area which is less than 250 km square, it is said to be plane surveying. If the area exceeds 250 km square, it is coming under geodetic surveying. The main difference between geodetic surveying and plane surveying is the curvature of earth is taken into account in geodetic surveying, while in plane surveying, the surveying area is taken as plane surface. Going to see about the secondary classifications of survey. Surveying is further classified into several types based on several factors. For example, based on the field of surveying, surveying is classified into three types. First one, land surveying. Second one, hydrographical surveying, then astronomical surveying. Suppose we are surveying an area in the land, is said to be a land survey, while surveying a water body, it is coming under hydrographical survey, and while surveying a area on the space, is said to be a astronomical survey. Surveying is further classified into several types based on the object of survey. Object is nothing but the purpose of surveying, like military survey, engineering survey, mine survey, geological and archaeological. Based on the objective of surveys, survey is classified as military survey, engineering survey, mine survey, geological survey, archaeological survey. Surveying is also classified based on the instruments used for surveying. For example, if you are using chain For surveying, it is said to be a
chain surveying. If you are using compass, it is said to be a compass surveying. Then plane table surveying. Theodolite survey, then tachyometric, photographic and aerial survey.
Based on the instruments used for surveying, surveying is classified as chain survey, compass survey, plane table survey, theodolite survey, tachyometric survey, photogrammetric survey and aerial survey. These are the classifications coming under instruments used. And according to the method of surveying, it is classified into further two types. First one, traversing. Second one, triangulation. See, surveying is primarily classified into two types called geodetic survey, plane survey, based on the area of surveying, and surveying is secondary classified into several types based on several factors like field of survey, like land, hydrographical, astronomical, and objective of survey, military, engineering, mine, geological and archaeological survey. Based on the instruments used for surveying, surveying is classified as chain survey, compass survey, plane table survey, theodolite survey, tachyometric survey, photogrammetric aerial. Then method of survey. Based on the method of surveying, surveying is classified as traversing and triangulation. Next we are going to see about the principle of surveying. Principles for surveying. First one, to work from. Whole to part. Second one, to locate a new station by measuring to reference points. These are the two basic principles of surveying: to work from whole to the part, to locate a new station by measuring a two reference points. To work from whole to the part. In this, a larger area is divided into smaller number of triangles.
For example, if you take a area in the form of hexagon,
in order to measure this area of a boundary,
we can split this boundary into number of triangles.
The process of splitting the area into number of triangles said to be called as triangulation. By measuring the area of these smaller triangles, we can measure the area of this boundary, and this principle is coming under to work from whole to the part. The main advantage of this principle is the error occurring during the computing of area of any boundary can be eliminated. To locate a new station by measuring a two reference point. For example, we are in need to mark a point R in the field. The point P and S should be marked before. The distance between P and S should be measured. And we can follow several methods. For example, we can draw the perpendicular offset from the line P and S, or else we can measure the angular distance between P to R. For example, alpha is the angle and P to R, beta. These two angles intersect at a point R. Or else we can measure the distance between PR and SR, and we can make a arc
from P and from S we can get the point PR and
SR. The main objective is we have to mark the point R with the help of these two reference points. This coming under the second principle to locate a new station, that is R, by measuring the two reference points, that is P and S.
Next, we are going to see about chain surveying. Before going to chain surveying, we have to know about chaining. What is meant by chaining? The process of determining the horizontal distance with the help of an instrument called a chain is said to be a chaining. Chaining is the process of measuring the horizontal distance by using an instrument called chain. What are the other instruments used for chain surveying? Chain. It is used to measure the horizontal distance. Arrows and pegs. It is used to mark the stations. Cross staff. It is used to mark the perpendicular offsets. Then ranging rod. The process of ranging we are using ranging rods. Cross staffs are further classified into three types: open cross staff, French cross staff, then adjustable cross staff. With the help of this open cross staff, we can make the 90 degrees perpendicular offsets. Well, with the help of French cross staff, we make the survey lines for 45 degree, 60 degree, and also 90 degree survey lines. With the help of this adjustable cross staffs, we can place at any angle. Then ranging rod. Rods are used for the purpose of ranging. They are generally 3 meters in height, and for every 0.2 meter they are alternatively painted with red and white. Before chaining, we have to know about ranging. What is meant by ranging? In order to specify distance from A to B, with the help of chain, the intermediate station C and D should be plotted. But the C and D should not be in the line A and B sometimes. In order to avoid that, the process can be followed. That means the point C and D should be in the line A and B. See, this process is said to be ranging. The process of aligning this intermediate points between this end points in a straight alignment is said to be a ranging. There are two methods adopted in ranging. First one, direct ranging. Second one, indirect ranging. And what is the difference between direct ranging and indirect ranging means? If the point C and D is visible from the point A and B, then we can adopt direct ranging. If the point C and D is not visible from the point A and B, it is coming under indirect ranging. There is also another name for indirect ranging called reciprocal ranging. This direct ranging is done by two methods. First one, by using line ranger.
By using I, there are four people with a ranging rod at the stations A, C, D and B. The person from A will direct the person from C and D to move forward and backward to be in line AB. With the help of naked eye, it is coming at a by using eye. In the method by using line ranger, an instrument called line ranger is used for ranging. In this, two prisms are there. The light from A will coincide with the line from B at the station C. With the help of line ranger, we can range the stations A, C, D, B in the straight alignment. Then we are going for indirect ranging or reciprocal ranging. If you are ranging in a hilly area, for example, these are the stations A, B and intermediate stations C and D are fixed. Here you can see the station D is not visible from point A and station C is not visible from point B. In this method, we can adopt the reciprocal method of ranging.
This is point A and this is point B. We have to ask the person from C to move forward to the point C1. And we ask the person from D to move to the point D1. D1 should be visible from B and it should be in line C1B. Like that, we have to ask the person from C1 to move forward to the new position called C2. See, from C2 it should be visible from point A and D1 and it should be in line AD1. The process is repeated by asking the person D1 to move forward to the new position D2. It should be in line BC2 and from D2 B is visible. It is continued until it reaches the point C and D. When this C and D is in line A and B, this method of ranging is said to be reciprocal ranging. Next, we are going to see about method of chaining. There are two methods of chaining. First one, direct method. Second one, indirect method. See, there is a procedure called stepping method is adopted in direct method. If you are chaining a steep slope area like this, we have to mark several stations as A, B, C. And we have to measure the vertical distance from A to B with the help of a scale. And we have to measure the horizontal distance with the help of scale. Like that, the vertical distance and the horizontal distance can be measured. Here it is D1 and D2. In order to compute the horizontal distance from the point A to C, we can simply add the distance D1 and D2. This is said to be a stepping method while we following a stepping procedure. Hence it is called a stepping method. It is coming under direct method of chaining. While indirect method of chaining is done by several methods. For example, by using a clinometer. By hypotenusal allowance and so on.
By using clinometer. Clinometer is an instrument, we can measure the vertical angle. For example, again we are chaining as a slope area. Here it is our point A
Here is our point B. We have to note the distance between point A to B. With the help of clinometer, we can simply measure the angle alpha, which is from A to B. Let us consider this as a triangle A, B, again it is a C. Alpha is the angle. Now to know the distance, distance D is equal to, and the vertical distance L, L into cos alpha.
With this we can measure the horizontal distance, which means the vertical distance L into the angular distance.
Next we are going to see about the what are the errors to be occurred while chaining.
Before that, we have to know what are the factors affecting chaining. The environmental factors, for example, if the temperature of the environment can be increased, the length of the chain can also increase. If the temperature falls, the length of the chain can be reduced because of shrinkage.
See, temperature is the factor which affects the chaining. Second one, pull.
If you are dragging the chain, if we give a larger pull, means the length of the chain can be increased and the link will break down.
Then slope.
If you are chaining a slopy area, it can also produce considerable error in chaining.
Sag.
If the chain is not straight, means there will be a sag occur.
It will reduce the length to be measured.
Then absolute length.
It is the error occur in the length of the chain. These are the errors
occurring chaining. Then we can know the what are the correction factors for chaining.
For example, if we take the temperature, the correction factor is alpha into Tm minus T naught into L.
Here Tm is the temperature at the time of measurement and T naught is the standard temperature and L is the original length of chain and alpha stands for coefficient of linear expansion.
And for pull, Cp is equal to Pm minus P naught into L divided by A into E.
Here Pm is the pull at the time of measurement and P naught is the standardized pull. And slope,
SCH stands for H square divided by 2L, where H by L is the slope. And for slack, it is L into WL square divided by 24 N square PM square.
Then for absolute length,
it is LM into C divided by L.
These are the correction factors to be applied while surveying. So far we have seen types of chaining and what are the methods of ranging.
Then we have to know about the what are the types of chain to be used. First one,
in our practice we are using metric chain.
Then there is also a chain called engineer's chain, Gunter's chain, then revenue chain.
These are the various types of chain we are using. Metric chain is
totally 20 meters or 30 meters in length.
There will be 100 links available. While in engineer's chain, it is
100 feet long and there is also 100 links available.
While in Gunter's chain, it is about
66 feet long and 100 links are there. While in revenue chain, it is 33 feet long and only 16 links are there.
For serving a larger area, we can adopt metric chain or inches chain. While the serving area is very smaller, we can adopt the revenue chain or Gunter's chain. In practice, normally the chain is made up of a material called galvanized iron. And at the end of, at the two ends of chain, there will be a brass handles. And every link is attached into three rings. And now to separate the distance, there will be a brass talis for every 5 meters. For every 1 meter, there will be a brass rings. These are the brass ring. This is said to be a brass tally. And this is the brass handle.
So far we have seen the what is mean by surveying, what are the classifications of surveying, what are the principles of surveying, and what is mean by chaining, and what are the methods adopted in chaining, and what are the instruments used for chaining and ranging. Then we are going to see about compass surveying. Compass surveying. In chain surveying, we are only measuring the distance. Since the measurement taken by chain surveying is said to be linear measurement, in compass surveying, we are measuring the angular, that means horizontal angle. This is said to be a angular measurement. There are two types of compass can be used for compass surveying. First one, prismatic compass. Second one, surveyor compass. Before getting into compass surveying, we have to know several terminologies. For example, meridian and bearing. What does mean by meridian? Meridian is a line joining the north pole and south pole. If the line joining the geographical north pole to the geographical south pole, then it is said to be a true meridian. Since we are using magnetic compass for surveying, if the line joining the magnetic north to the magnetic south, then it is said to be a magnetic meridian. Then what is mean by bearing? Bearing is the horizontal angle measured from the north. If you are measuring the horizontal angle with reference to geographical north, that means geographic true meridian, then it is said to be a true bearing. If you are taking the horizontal angle from the magnetic meridian, that is magnetic north, then it is said to be a magnetic bearing. So far we have seen what is mean by surveying, and we have seen about chain surveying, and in next class we are going to see about the methodology adopted in compass surveying. Thank you.